If you haven't met me, my name is Sally Johnson, and I'm the executive director of the Dalles Art Center. And I'm genuinely thrilled to be here tonight with Lori Mason. And I welcome Lori. And
we give you a round of applause too, Sally.
Oh, well, yeah. The Dalles Art Center builds community through engaging and exploring art because a creative and connected community thrive together. So we're here to really build, be a part of the community. We are the community, and the community is how we are here. We come from all the way back to 1959 when a group of people who were kind of their North Star was learning how to paint and make art, and they joined together and found teachers and would go out and paint together, come back and critique, show each other their work, and just encourage and keep themselves going. And then that developed into an art association, and this long lineage, we are all benefits of so much love and care for this community and for this place and for the idea of what creativity and what art can do for our own individual lives, but also as a community, how powerful that can be to join us together, remind us of how we're actually connected and similar, but also just help us live healthier, more full, rich lives. And that's what we're here for. And all of you have made that happen. The Art Center is really here because of our supporters and our community. And I'm thrilled that we get to host such an amazing show. And I just want to note that right as the show opened there, and I put a board out, the New York Times posted an article about fiber art, textile art is, it's time is now, it's fun. They think it's fun to hear. We actually know it's been here for a while. But I thought that was fun timing, and so I put that out. And it's been wonderful to work with Lori on building this show. I had the honor of going to Lori's studio, and we started talking and asking great questions about what kind of show would this be, and what does Lori's work, how do you approach it? What has influenced your work over time? And those conversations started to put together some ideas, and one was really about there's an amazing story of your career and sort of a through line of some interesting work and ideas. And then Lori came here and we looked at the Art Center and thought, what would make sense here, and how do we tell that story as a textile artist who makes amazing textile work but also has been a designer of fabrics and patterns. And your title, and Lori titled the show Life and Pattern, and I think that was so much a part of the conversations as we went into thinking about this show. And now we're here,
yeah.
And we've opened the show, and I'm thrilled in how the stories it's telling and how what it looks like in the studio. And the way we're gonna, the way the art shop works is I have maybe six questions for Lori, and we start with that. But the evolve of this, and the fun part is, once my questions are done, we open it to the floor, and we usually have great conversations from people in the audience. Cool.
Yeah.
Great. Okay. So, my first question is, I don't mean it to be a whopper, but it's kind of a whopper. Can you give us an overview of your career and really how you got to where you are now?
Yeah, I'm happy to do that. I think it's a great first question. But before I do that, I just want to thank Sally. I want to thank the Dalles Art Center. I want to thank all the volunteers that helped put the show together and all the board members who are here and all of you. It really is very meaningful to me to have this show up. So thank you. I had a very winding, zigzagging career. Right out of high school, I realized I had been surrounded by artists in my family, architects. what seemed obvious was to go to art school. And I'm also a very practical and pragmatic person, and I said, I don't want to narrow down what feels comfortable. It felt like the obvious thing wasn't the thing I should do. So I ended up going to Reed College to do a liberal arts degree. And in my junior year abroad, I went to York, England, and took my first textile class. And as many of you know, England has a really rich tradition in textiles. And that was a real turning point for me. Also because it felt like art and design and sort of making something for practical use was something that really resonated for me. So I came back to Portland and I transferred to what was then the Oregon School of Art and Craft, and did a fibers degree there. It was actually not a degree, it was a certificate. And then in the year after I graduated with the certificate, they got their BFA accreditation, so I went back and got my BFA and did a second thesis. And that thesis was basically taking photographs that I'd taken of things in nature, rocks or whatever, and I actually used a very early Photoshop. Photoshop was probably in 1995, and I made like repeat patterns in Photoshop. It was just crazy having to work with, but I was sort of printing fabric, and one of my professors said, hey, I know somebody at Nike who designs fabric. Do you want to go meet her? And I was like, yes. so he took me, that is a yes. So we went on this little field trip and had lunch with, and I wish I remembered her name, but she had like drawings and paintings and they would scan them. It felt very artistic in the textile design there at that time. And so of course I said, well, how did you get here? Schooling did you have? And she said, well, I did the 2-year associate degree at the Fashion Institute of Technology in New York in textile design for industry. And I applied and I went the next year. I was just sort of on fire to try and find something that felt practical and also used art at the same time. So I went to FIT. And on a Hail Mary, I sent my portfolio at the end of that year back to Nike, and they hired me. So I worked for them for a few years in their apparel department, designing prints for apparel. So all those different sport categories, so running, golf, volleyball, and so I was there for about 3 years, and it was a tough place to work. I don't know, Lee, probably. It was challenging for me as sort of more of an artist, although the graphic designers there were amazing. We were housed in the graphic design department. But in the end, I felt like I wasn't, working in a corporate setting was being challenging for me. So I quit and I started my own business, making a line of sort of modern quilts, and I did the national craft show circuit for about 3 years until I had my son. So all these things, zigging and zagging and stopping and starting, and once I kind of got back into work, I wanted to revisit the textile design, but in a more fiber-focused way, so I licensed my designs to national fabric companies who were focusing on the quilting industry. So that's all the fabrics that you see over there is from that period of my life. While all this was happening, from Reed to doing these textiles, I had started making memorial quilts. I made my first one for a very close friend of mine. And there's a whole story about how I started that, which I would love to tell. Should I tell?
Yeah,
okay. And I think it's kind of, it feels like a universal story. It feels like it's a difficult story to tell because I behaved in a way when I was 18 to a friend that I don't feel good about. And it revolved around her sister dying and me not being there for her. Me sort of being afraid of what to say. I think we can all relate to that. And my best friend's sister died. I told her I would call her, and I didn't. And I was afraid. I wanted her to she was ready. And that's not really how it works, I've discovered. And so we worked that out. But a couple years later, another friend asked me to make her a memorial quilt with her dad's ties. And at that point, I felt like I really need to show up for my friends who are grieving. So I made that friend a quilt with her father's ties. And what happened in that process and that making of the quilt, the giving her of the quilt, seeing the combination of grief and textiles and memory was really powerful. And a couple years after that, my grandmother died, and I was able to make four memorial quilts with her clothing. And so that, for me, kind of cemented just my heart work. You know, I knew that I wanted to do more of this, but it's not an easy thing to market. You know, it's like people need to say, hey, Lori, you know, is trustworthy, or is, you know, passionate, or, you know, it's a delicate process, but it's one that I have learned. I've gotten it's gotten easier for me to talk to people just frankly about their grief and about the stories of their loved ones, and it's really fuels what I feel like I can help people, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So at some point then the fabric, I was sort of doing two parallel jobs basically in my studio, and at one point I just felt like I really wanted to focus on the memorial quilts, and so I kind of let the textile design go. In terms of making it, so that's running.
Yeah, and to now you make memorial quilts for people, and also still studio quilts.
And yeah, studio and quilts for special occasions.
Yeah.
So you know, anniversaries or weddings or, but quilts that carry meaning.
Yeah. And for those of you who haven't seen the full show, you have two of your grandmother.
Yeah, in the made. Corner there. Yeah.
That you mentioned,
yeah.
Which are beautiful. And I just, for me, Lori, your memorial quilts that you were talking about, there's the intersection of people coming to you in a moment of significant change in their lives or losing somebody and being in grief. And you're hearing their stories about this person and taking their clothing, mementos, understanding, and translating that into something that honors them, but then that memento is of comfort to people's grief. I just think it's so rich what you're doing there. And reading the story, have people read the stories?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just really powerful. And I just think, I don't know if every artist could hold that kind of space for people, and your practicality is so important, because I can see how you could help hear all these stories about a person, but then start to lay out the path and the structure for how to tell that story.
Yeah, I think that is what, just the way that I work and what I find really interesting is to, and it happened when I would design textiles as well, but finding the kernel of what the story is. And I don't know, I mean, who am I to pick the kernel for somebody's story, right?
Yeah.
But usually there's something that pops out when they tell me about their loved one. And then just kind of distilling that idea down to like a quilt block. You know, maybe it's just a chevron shape, you know, in the case of Joe's quilts. And I like order. I mean, I like order. I come from a dramatic family. So I like to order things. I like to have things clean and patterned. And
But it's wonderful. Speaking of your family, your family immediately became part of our conversations about the show. Could you talk about the influence of your family on your work? And you know what people could see in the show about that kind of family legacy or influence.
Mm-hmm. and showing me how to marry being an artist and having a family and having a studio and being, what do you call that when you're very
structured?
Yeah, organized. Structured and organized and diligent about basically practicing your art. My grandparents lived in a house that my great grandfather designed, and my grandmother had a studio in her, a big studio with all of her stainless steel bending spot welding, and she stood this high and was like making these huge pieces. But she did it every day, you know, and so I would go visit her and I'd sit in her studio and she'd, you know, tell me things and go pick up the stainless steel in her big truck and had a lot of opinions about being an artist, and that was amazing. And then my mom was a photographer, is a photographer, and had a business when I was still at home, a portraiture business, and she had a darkroom in our basement, and sometimes she'd close the door, and I had to deal with entertaining myself, and you know, it was just part of life, and I think that's a lot what got instilled in me, and just the permission to feel like that's a worthy thing to do. In terms of my actual designs of my work, I'm not sure it's as I can point to the connection there, but it's more about my daily life.
We had interesting conversations about how there's been architects in her family, and making quilts has a certain type of architecture to it and structure. But also, there is a book about her grandmother and her artwork, and I highly recommend people look through it. She's pretty amazing, fantastic. And my favorite picture of you of all time is you sitting in one of her sculptures as a little gal. I mean, so, what I hear, you know, as you're talking, what I was hearing is, oh, you grew up understanding the work of art, which is a daily practice, a building of one's understanding of what you're creating, what you're learning, and how you're building on that over time. But it's not every now and then, it's part of a way of
working. And, you know, my grandmother loved to tell me, you know, when things should be changed just a little bit. I was at FIT and they were at Princeton, and I would go visit them, and I often had to paint over the weekend because it was a really intense year. And she'd stand over me and be like, yeah, and she was Austrian, yeah, you need to just change, the curve needs to go a little that way. Sometimes I did what she said.
Yeah, so that's part of the process of it.
Yeah.
That was wonderful, thank you. And so one thing I was hoping you might do is just, there's so many beautiful stories about your memorial quilts, but would you mind just maybe choosing one and just telling us that story?
Yeah. I thought I would talk about Joe over here, because this whole area inside is really, all the quilts were for one family and one man who passed away. So Joe Gunter was the mayor of Salinas, California, and he died in 2020, and suddenly. And his daughter found me on the internet, had a bunch of his clothes and was interested in having quilts made, and so she emailed me and we talked. And the first thing I do is talk to people on the phone. I really feel like the first thing I need to do is establish trust with people, because most of the time people are shipping me boxes of clothing from all over, sometimes across the ocean. And so I want them to feel really confident that I'm gonna respect their things, and that they understand what the process is, because a lot of people don't. They're like, what's a memorial quilt? What do I do? You know. So we talk on the phone, and I just want to hear them talk about their loved one, and I'm taking notes, handwritten notes, just to see also if those little kernels pop out. So I have my note sheet that I take when I talk to them. So Jody called and she said my dad was a Vietnam vet. He was a Marine in Vietnam. He was a police officer for many years. she had some issues with her stepmom, but she finally got her dad's clothing, and she said, "I really just love your designs, and can you create something?" She wanted, I think, as many quilts as you can make out of the stuff I'm sending you, so that was fun. So I started thinking about Joe's service, which really seemed to be the pillar of what he did for, you know, his community. And so I started looking at badges and patches of police and military, and so just sort of got it down to this chevron shape, you know, that you see in a lot of police badges and stuff. And from there, then I start building the design. I work in Illustrator, Adobe Illustrator, and I'm just moving shapes around, and sometimes I just work in black and white to get the design down. And then once she shipped all the clothing, she said, if you can do five quilts, I want five quilts. So I designed probably four or five designs for her, and then we picked two. She picked her favorite two, and then we did three in one design and two in the other. Because a lot of times with a family, I call them a family of quilts because they're for the family, it's nice to have a similar pattern, but every quilt is different because there's only one, you know, pinstriped shirt, and there's only one green plaid shirt or whatever. So I'm always trying to figure out what are the fabrics that will stand out and be the you know, like the center, if there's only a little red, you know, be the contrast. So she picked the designs, then I go to work, then I divide up the fabric, like, okay, this is gonna go in this quilt, that's gonna go in that quilt, and then I start piecing.
And you disassemble all the
quilts. Yeah, and that's a lot of work. I cut apart all of the fronts and cuffs off, and I basically get rid of all of the seams and everything, and then have, you know, just the flat fabric that I can use. Occasionally I'll put in buttons, but generally I consider the fabric to be my palette and less about the clothing. Like, I'm not there to show that it was jeans, right? It's a particular blue. They can give me 5 to 10 different jeans, and they're all different shades of blue. I mean, that's just so lovely. I mean, I would love for somebody to just give me that, because it's a palette, you know. So I'm really working with color. I'll stack up all the clothes, and then I'll divide them by color or light and dark or whatever. I mean, every box is different. So I made five of the quilts. I sent, and then I sent them to a quilter. She was at the opening. She does all my machine quilting for me. Some of your quilters. So she has a big quilting machine, so she does that, and we've been working together for years, and I trust her, and she trusts me, and it's a great working relationship. So she quilts, we decide the pattern, and then she gives that back to me, and then I'll bind them and pack them up and send them on. So once Jody got, so I asked her, I said, you know, there's some leftover fabric, I'll just stick it in the box you want to keep. Sometimes I recycle what's left over of the garments, but she said, no, I'll send it all back. So she opened up the quilts with her. She actually didn't call me right away, which sometimes I've learned it's okay, because people aren't ready, you know, like they get this box and it's like, I had one person say, I can't, you know, I need to actually have my son, and that's what Jody said. She said, I needed both my sons to come home from college, and they were coming home. So she said, don't worry. And so then I get the email later, like, it's just all the memories coming back. But then she said, I'm sending the stuff right back. I want two more for the wall. So those are the top pieces on there. So we did another. And we took one of the designs that I made for her and made two more. So she got a total of seven.
And are you often working it in series?
If somebody says, I want two quilts, and, you know, they're for my sons, or, you know, I want one for me and one for my sister, or whatever, we'll often do the same pattern, because as you can see, especially the middle ones there, you can hardly tell sometimes that it is the same pattern.
Right.
And I like that.
Yeah.
So.
Like you said, it's a family of quilts.
It is.
And it's that, I mean, I think as a family members, that connection and that shared pattern.
stories.
Yeah.
I just, that's what I was thinking. We see a glimpse here of that, but there's so many.
Yeah, and I've created quilts for people who died who have been 2 years old and 99 years old and everything in between and all types of death. And I'm blessed with being able to hear people's stories because they want to tell them.
What about Lori, if you look back on your career, what's been, it's kind of a two-parter.
Okay.
So what's come easy to you? And then what are some of the things, what are challenges that you face in, you know, your work and your career?
I'd say easy, my conviction that fabric was it, but I never doubted that I was a textile person. That, and even in art school, you know, where we had to take different things, you know, it was always the fibers that came back that I just somehow loved. I also had the support of my family and my husband to make the art that I needed to make and not have to, you know, put myself, you know, I had choices, and that was very fortunate, and I'm really thankful for that. Challenges, lots of challenges. but I would say the biggest challenge for me and the biggest kind of tug that I had as a designer and an artist was feeling, and this was true at Nike and also designing textiles for the clothing industry, is you have to be really interested in trends and what's happening in the industry and what this company is doing or what who's wearing that or who's, and I just wasn't. And I really wanted to be because I knew that, especially at Nike, that the designers that had their finger on the pulse of what was happening were, there was a language that they were using that people, you know, things sold through. They, you know, they were selling. And I always struggled and I always doubted myself that, am I making something somebody wants? And you know, and it was hard, you know. And then with the quilting, I mean, I love designing. I think I'm a great designer, but I'm not great at making things that will sell, you know. And that can be really hard. There's a lot of self doubt. And so when I felt like easy is, you know, people say, how do you take a box of clothing and make it into this thing? And I'm like, well, it just happens. You know, that's the sort of, and my friend Amanda calls it alchemy or something. You could call it a muse, or you could call it, I sort of call it clarity. It's like, I just know where things are going to go.
Yeah.
It's weird. And maybe it's because I've been doing it for so long, but there's a something that I can't even call my own. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's a creative something. I don't know.
Yeah. It's interesting as you were talking about that. I was thinking, well, in Nike or design for fabrics, it's you designing for that, like a lot, like the idea of the concept of an audience, like multiple. But in memorial quilts, you're thinking very intimately and understanding, and you know, it's just.
It's very intuitive.
Very intuitive.
It's very personal, and I love one-on-one. I just love that feeling of connection and people feeling like it's helping them, or they're like, thank you, you know? It's like, nobody thanked me at Nike. what it was about, but it helps for me. It helps to know that what I'm making is helping someone.
That makes sense. How about, you know, you look back, like all you know now, all you've done, all the things you've faced and sort of grown, if you could go back in time and just talk to that maybe 20-something year old, as you're like deciding things, what would you want to tell her that you know now?
Don't take it so personally. And take a marketing class.
And take a marketing class.
Two.
good friends.
Yeah, who knows? Yeah. You know, marketing, you know, artists will tell you, obviously, it's hard to market your own work and share. I mean, when I think about this show, like, people say, oh, you're having this show. I'm like, I'm sharing what I'm doing. That's what I want. I just want people to know that it's there because I'm working privately with people. It's a very private process. And I'm glad that I was able to show other things because I told Sally, I was like, all my work is in people's homes. I can't really have a show. But I think we came up with it.
I think we came up with it. I love your advice to yourself, don't think it's so personally, because it's, in a way, it's, yes, it's so important. And then ironically, you work very personally.
Right.
It's like the best, it's like, don't take it personally, but then by not taking it personally, you can actually do this very intimate work that isn't about you, but is like for people. It's really cool. Good advice. Okay, I just have one more question, which you kind of just mentioned, but I get, you know, by the way, I've known Lori since we were teenagers.
Oh.
And so I do have to testify that.
With a 40-year hiatus when we did our lives, and anyway.
But from afar, she really, really were textiles. Like, I just, and I remember the first time I realized that's what you're doing, I just thought, and for some reason, it made so much sense to me, and I just thought it was so interesting and cool. And why did it, like, my question is, why textiles? Like, what, do you have a sense of that? Because it is you.
It is me. I mean, I fell in love with sewing at age 10. My mom taught me how to hem some pants, and I think it was a combination of the sewing machine. And I was working in her finishing studio. She was a photographer, so she had this open studio, and she just showed me and then left. And I turned on some music, and I was just in there for like 2 hours. It was like, wow, I love working by myself, and I love this sewing thing, and I love pinning, and I love pressing, and I like making it neat, and that was cool. And then I thought, oh, well, I must like sewing clothes. Oh, textiles is about sewing clothes. So I took a class in sewing. You know, it was like 12, and you sew this halter and go, and it was at a fabric store, and they're like, okay, we're going to sew this thing, now you guys go through the store and pick whatever fabric you want. And I was just like, oh. And I remember the fabric was this, I mean, I was 12, so it was like little strawberries, and I remember making the halter top, and it just didn't fit, and it was like, you know, clumsy, but I loved that fabric. And I feel like it was about the fabric, but I still didn't get that in my head, so I figured, okay, I'm gonna take more sewing classes, and it's about fashion, and then it was when I took this textile design class in England, you know, when I was, whatever, 21, it's like, oh, right, I can do textiles, and textiles are personal, right? We wear them all day, we sleep in them, they're around us all the time, and then finding this medium where textiles have this extra meaning, right? And it's personal, and it's memory, and it's grief, and it's joy, and all that. So, yeah.
It's very rich.
Yeah.
That's great. All right, so does anybody else have questions? Questions from
any particular piece or any process?
I have a question. So a family sends you a box of clothes, and fabrics come in different forms, cotton, wool, polyester, I mean, all kinds. And I mean, do you say only cotton?
Or? I used to. And because it's stretchy, and I was never actually, you know, my mom just told me how to hem a pair of pants, but I never had like proper sewing. Like, and there's so many sewers out there that are amazing and they know how to do it. But I was just the stretchy thing. I was working on an old Singer that didn't have a walking. It was like, so I was like, no stretchy. And then, you know, can you use the t-shirt? No. I didn't like saying no because, you know, things are meaningful.
Yeah.
So that piece there, Francis's Flowers, this one here with the red. So it's actually a friend of mine, and her mom was an impeccable dresser, and she said, and her mom died a few years ago, because then I'm not actually sewing seams that are gonna stretch. So all the, and then I discovered the backing, you know, stabilizing everything. Mm-hmm. So I pretty, I say no to like things that are too thick or things that I can't, if I can't use an iron, at least on low, to put that stabilizer, then that's tricky, or if things are too lacy. And it also depends on how you're gonna use it. So if it's a wall piece, and doesn't, isn't gonna be washed all the time, then we have a discussion, you know. But I do combinations of wool and silk, neckties, shirts, and stretchy, you know, if it's stretchy, I'll just put a stabilizer on it. It makes it a little bit stiffer, but once you put the batting inside, it's fine.
Good question. How do you market yourself?
So I have a website, and I put up my work, and I talk about the work on the website, and I have done a few interviews. I've been interviewed on grief blogs. You know, people hear what I do, and they're like, you should talk to hospice people. And I'm like, well, hospice people are helping people die. And they're not really in the space. Although I will say that many people have said, I wish I knew that you, the work you did, because we threw everything away. Mm-hmm. And it, that time between when somebody passes and when you're cleaning out their house or whatever, that's a, some people, you know, grief is different for everyone. Some people just want to get rid of everything. Some people keep their, I mean, I had one man come to me and he kept his partner's clothing in the closet for 25 years and was finally ready. You know, and I made some pillows for him, but you lost my train of thought.
What? You're talking about grief.
Grief, yeah. How I market my work, yeah. So grief blogs, that's really great because that's where people are trying to get support, you know, and feel like they're not alone. And so I also a couple grief podcasts as well. So I'd like to do more. I mean, I'm busy, but I would like to do more, you know, quilts per year, I guess. But I never wanted to push it. You know, there's, like I said, there's this balance between, you know, it's about the people that want to come to me. I just want to share, right? It's like, where can I put my work that people can see it and know that that's possible, you know?
Yeah, that's interesting.
Did you see the U.S. Open tennis?
No.
There was Nike had two players, a woman and a man, wearing their design on their tennis costumes.
Oh, nice. I didn't see
Yeah.
That. You don't want to use my dad's quilts. Basically what he said. But he traveled through the Middle East, and he has this amazing collection of Middle Eastern fabric that he collected. And so that, yeah, it's Dirk's Islamic Star is the quilt that's on my website. And so, yeah, I've done that a few times where people maybe have collected textiles, and I'll use that. Yeah.
So could a quilt be designed solely from stories and memories to you that would inspire a quilt?
That I would then use fabrics that I find, or?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Like I say, I mean, like Joe's quilt, I could have used store-bought fabric or whatever, but I had that chevron, and you know, it meant something to Jody, right? And we can, once you hear the story, you're like, oh yeah, I see that, you know.
Okay.
So, absolutely. It's for the person who I'm making the quilt for, you know, it's their memories. So if I create something that evokes sometimes they only have one thing and I fill it with other stuff. Mm-hmm. And that thing becomes the centerpiece or whatever. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I have a number of antique quilts, and I've always been interested to see how different the durability is of different fabrics. So certain fabrics in a recurring pattern will kind of fall apart after 50, 60, 70 years. Mm-hmm. Do you do anything to preserve?
I'm not a preservationist. I have been asked that many times because it's not everyone, but many people have these amazing quilts. In fact, my husband's family, they were in the South, and they had these beautiful quilts, and they were folded up and kept in the basement, in the damp, and it was thick. And I went, it's a special, you know, craft to fix those, and I don't know how to do that. I patched things, but when fabric, especially light damage and damage from moisture, when the fabrics are just disintegrating, you can't stitch them together. It's hard. It's hard to see. Sorry.
And I do have another question. How do you figure out your pricing? How does that work? And what kind of money do people invest in the memorial?
That's also been challenging for me because it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
And I'm doing it all myself. And that's how I want it. I don't want to hire other people. I have hired a friend to help me deconstruct on some projects. Like I had a 9-quilt commission and there was a deadline. So I had a friend come and help me undo. But I kind of give myself a wait. I mean, it's really hard. It's sort of, they're more expensive than I would like at some, sometimes people come and they just can't afford to have a piece made. And so I do pillows and I do smaller things. I'm not a grant writer, but I thought, I would like to write a grant or have some resources that I can offer this to people who maybe can't afford to pay for it. Sort of half answers your question.
I think many artists struggle with how to price and the invest, there's no exact algebra of hours to outcome to output, and it's challenging for many artists. It's an ongoing quandary.
Yeah.
So, Lori,
yeah.
When you do ever have disagreements with your clients that where they want a design that you just think it's not a really good design? How do you deal with that?
The question was, do you ever have disagreements with your client that maybe they choose a design that I don't like or give me a fabric that I don't like? So I try not to get in that position because I consider what I'm doing for them, for them. So I had a client, Texas, I think, and she said, I want a quilt with these particular traditional quilt patches. Okay. They weren't, I didn't really like them, but I made her the quilt, and she loved it, and I may not put it on my website, because maybe I don't want to advertise or market that that's something I like to do, but it's not always about me. And so that was what I did. And sometimes I have those, and sometimes somebody says, do whatever you want. I love your work. And so it's, you just take what you, get. I know. But it's, people have, so this piece, she wanted, the piece that's on that wall, she wanted, an AIDS ribbon in the center. Like, so there's things that people just say, this has to be in the quilt. And I say, of course it's going to be right in the center. So it's a give and take to, I have some people who have a box of t-shirts and they're like, can you make me a t-shirt quilt? And I have people that do that very well, but people that found me have seen the work and somehow connect with it.
How do you choose your color palettes? If they give you just a bunch of random, that doesn't look like it's going to go together.
Yeah.
How do you pull that together?
I ask them to put the pieces that they really want in the quilt that have to be in there in one pile, or put a note on them. And then I tell them, which is true, that give me more than you think I'll need. And if there are some pieces that don't get in, is that all right with you? And so that gives me a little out, like maybe there's one, because sometimes they'll send me like a pile jacket or something, and it just really doesn't go with the rest. But I always check, I'm like, is it okay if I don't use this because of blah, blah, blah? And they are always like, yes, that's fine. Or sometimes there's like sweatshirt material, like they have these gorgeous fabric, and then they say there's this sweatshirt from my alma mater. I'm like, oh, okay. How about I piece together a back and then you see it on the back?
Great.
You know, so it's, there's ways around. Mm-hmm. There's ways to work that and get things in there that people really want. I want to put as everything that they want in the quilt, and sometimes the colors, it's not usually the colors, it's usually the fabric type that trips me up. Yeah.
I have one more question.
Okay.
I wanted you to talk about your tartans. Mm-hmm. Like, how did that come to you, and like, what is this work for you?
Yeah.
The tartan quilts
are
from these walls.
Yeah, there's three tartan quilts. There's one behind the desk, and there's two big ones.
did that come about?
Yeah, I wanted to show, like, mostly I don't show, like, oh, here's the pocket or whatever, but those were all handkerchiefs that I met, like old, and so I just wanted to show a little bit that that's what it was, you know, that it had such nice edging and nice embroidery and that kind of thing.
I thought it was like the EY or some kind of imperfection.
Yeah.
Something that was so perfect.
Yeah.
I've been calling it the wabi sabi. And
that one?
Do you know, well, that little line, that's like the idea of perfection and then
breaking it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other questions? We've been going. I think it's
after. Do you know how many memorial quilts you've made to date? Do you keep track of them?
I don't keep track of the number.
How many years have you been?
Yeah, so I made my first one in like 2020, maybe, 99, and then just started making more. And most of them are photographed and most of them are on my website. So. And the more I work, the longer I have to scroll down to find what was that pattern I did for somebody. Because a lot of times people, if they don't know what pattern they want, I'll just say, you know, like, go to the website and go to the quilt gallery and just tell me, even if we're not going to do a pattern that I've done before, tell me which ones you like, that you're drawn to, and I can make, you know, do a something like it or something like that. So
another question is, like in these quilts over here, how do you know? Does Illustrator help you with this, or is just your math brain helping you with this? I need so many strips of this dark blue and so many strips of this light blue, and how do you know that you're going to have enough?
Yeah. I tell people there's this weird thing that happens, and it's probably because I've been doing it a while, and I know kind of how much a shirt. It's great when I get extra large shirts or when I get a skirt, you know, and it's like, I got a lot of material. It's like, okay, if it's a throw size and I have this many shirts, it's probably going to work out. But I will, sometimes I measure, you know, like, okay, I've got three dark blue shirts and I'm going to put them not everywhere.
Right.
And then I do work to, like, in a tenth scale. And I know how much seam allowance, so I know how big pieces are.
Mm-hmm.
So I have, like pages on the real complicated ones of, you know, and I work an eighth of an inch too. I don't just do quarter inch because I think sometimes doing an inch and an eighth, we're so used to seeing things in quarter inch or whatever, like our Western, you know, I mean, even though eighths inch are Western, but I'm not doing millimeters, but somehow doing the proportions in a way that you wouldn't, it's not easy on your mat or whatever.
Right.
But I have this sort of thing that happens where I'm like, wow, there was just enough of that shirt. And I'm telling you, it happens over and over again. Like, I really hope I have enough yellow to do the background. You know, I just did one with like 100 ties.
Oh my goodness.
And most of, on this one, there were a lot of yellow, so that was the background. I'm like, okay, well, I'm just gonna have faith that it's pretty much gonna make it. You know, ties are weird. You've gotta like, and I had just enough. I'm like, there it is again. You know, and you know, it's probably, you know, I work intuitively, and I, you know, I sort of know how big things are, but there is sort of this just enough thing that happens.
Because you're not working a normal yard.
I am not.
I need a yard and a quarter of this color, and yeah.
No. But it makes it challenge. I like the challenge of it.
Well, it's very challenging.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Well, I want to say thank you, Lori. I'm so glad. I'm so grateful to you. This journey of this show has been amazing, and I just to see it live.
Great for me to be like, oh, I've been working a while. You know, it's like, I see it all.
It's really like a retrospective.
It is.
I want to mention also that Lori does not sell her fabric anywhere, really, at
all, except at the Dalles Art Center. How about that, everybody? An exclusive. And we are fortunate that she's the back quarter bundles.
Yeah.
And then we're also selling, you can actually purchase bolts, yardage from the bolts. So talk to Chris or Nancy if you are interested in that. But we think that's pretty special. One of a kind.
Yeah.
Limited exclusive. See, I'm a marketer. Yeah. And can we get Lauren? Thank you all for coming to the artist talks every month as part of an exhibit. We host an artist talk, and it's the opportunity to kind of dig in and just learn more about what they think about, what's influenced them, and they're usually pretty rich, like tonight was. And then I also just want to mention, if you haven't, if you don't get our monthly newsletter, it's entirely filled with events and programs and classes and things. It's a wonderful thing if you are interested in art or learning about art and things that we're doing. And you can sign up easily on our website, or our folks at the counter can help you. And thank you so much. And I hope to see you all soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.